Now that we are familiar with the MNIST dataset, let's now implement the multilayer perceptron and train it on this dataset. The previous video ended with a quick visual check of the MNIST dataset here, and now we are getting to the exciting part, implementing our model. So first, let's take a look at images here, which are mini batches. So this variable images refers to the mini batches we obtain from the train loader here. So let's take a look at the dimension of images first. So the dimensions here are 64, 1, 28, 28. So the first number represents the batch size. 64 is our batch size, so we have 64 images here. And then the second number are the number of channels. So we have one channel because it's a grayscale or black and white image here. And then we have the height and the width. So we have 28 times 28 as the height and the width of the images. Now you might wonder how we can put that into the model. So for that, we are going to reshape this image, the 28 by 28 image, into a vector. So suppose for simplicity, this 28 by 28 image here is a 4 by 5 image with one color channel. So here is a simplified version of this. We have the input image 1 here, handwritten 1, 4 times 5. And we reshape that as a vector. So we are concatenating these rows into one long vector. And that is our input feature vector that will be fed into the multilayer perceptron. So how are we going to achieve that? We can, in PyTorch, use the torch.flatten function. So here we are calling flatten to flatten these images. And we are starting at dimension 1, so which means that we are flattening everything after dimension 1. We are flattening the channels, the height and the width. We only have one channel, so we are essentially flattening the 28 by 28, which should result in a 784 dimensional vector. So let's see if that's correct. So yeah, we can see we have now 64 images as 784 dimensional vectors. And now that we are familiar with the flatten function, we can implement our multilayer perceptron. So notice that the only difference to before to the XOR multilayer perceptron is that we inserted this torch flatten. And this allows the multilayer perceptron now to work with image data by making these flat vectors. So yeah, I'm not going to go over the details here because they are exactly the same as we discussed previously for the XOR dataset. So we can now directly go to the training loop. And again, we do the same thing. We define our compute accuracy function, which is again exactly the same function we used for the XOR video. So we are also not going to go into detail of how this works because it's exactly the same function. And boringly enough, the training loop is also going to be exactly the same. Let's paste it here from our previous XOR dataset. The only difference here is that we have a different number of input features and a different number of classes compared to our XOR dataset. But here, for example, I even left the learning rate the same. You may want to change this in a real world case, but yeah, except these inputs here and maybe the number of epochs, everything is the same as before, so we don't have to go over the details again. So now let's actually run this training loop and see what the results are. So yeah, it's training. Yeah, and it's training a little bit more slowly because first of all, we have more data points, but secondly, it's also a bigger network because we have a larger first hidden layer due to the increased number of input features. We have now 784 input features instead of 2 input features in the XOR dataset. But yeah, as we can see, it's training pretty quickly. After the first training epoch, we already have 88% training accuracy and 88% validation accuracy. We can see this network is not overfitting very much because the training and validation accuracies are very similar. And yeah, after 10 epochs, we reach 97% training accuracy and 95% validation accuracy. So in this notebook, we implemented a multilayer perceptron and trained it on the MNIST dataset. We saw that it achieved 95% validation accuracy, which is actually pretty good. In the next video, let's see how well it actually does on the test set.